Within 6 months, that group increased sales by $100 million. And we went from $1.2 billion to $4.5 billion a year. And it wasn't because we taught them any more skills to be real estate agents. Mm. We taught them how to change the way they thought about themselves. We taught them how to change their habits. Maxwell Maltz wrote a great book many, many years ago in the probably the 70s called Psycho-Cybernetics, yes. Right? And Maxwell Maltz was a surgeon who performed surgery on people. And what he notices, even after plastic surgery that he performed on people, some people didn't see any change in their faces. And it was visible to everybody else, but not to them. So we all have a map of reality. We have a map of what we think we look like. And any deviation on the physical level to that map, to that visual representation we have in our brains, that doesn't match the map, your brain deletes or distorts it. So when we were working with real estate agents or when I worked with business owners, in addition to upgrading knowledge and skills, if you think about how, let's say income, we have set points for how much income we earn. So whether it's 10,000 a year or 20 or 50 or 100 or a million, it doesn't matter. We get this set point and then we behave the way we need to behave and we feel what we need to feel to earn that income. And over a period of time, it becomes part of the brain's default mode network. So we develop set points for everything. And so if the set point's in the brain, and there's a psycho-cybernetic mechanism in the brain, a control and response mechanism in the brain, and it's our brain, why not learn how to reset the set point? When we take, let's say, visualization, right, and you start to see yourself, even if the picture's not clear in your mind, of achieving the next level of your success, whether it's releasing weight and keeping it off, getting into a relationship that you love and are happy in, whether it's to make 2 or 3 or 5 times more money and live a certain type of lifestyle that allows you to do the things that freedom with having money allows you to do. If you start in your mind first and you impress that through conscious efforts into the subconscious mind, it then causes thoughts and emotions and behaviors. I like to use language patterns as well that are gonna empower me versus disempower me. Self-talk is so critical. And so I'm consistently paying attention to how am I speaking to myself? Am I speaking to myself in a kind, motivating, empathetic, compassionate way? Or am I consistently self-deprecating and putting myself down? I used to think a lot, when I was younger, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not worthy. Those thoughts, lots of fear of being embarrassed, fear of failure, fear of being ashamed. And I still have the thoughts every once in a while, especially when I'm setting new goals. Are you smart enough to achieve that? Are you good enough to achieve that? Even when I got into really diving deep into the brain science and even my new book, I was petrified to release my book. It took me 2 years to write it because now I'm entering another whole domain of neuroscience and neuropsychology with world-renowned experts that I've worked with for years. But now here I am putting myself out there with, hey, this is neuroscientifically correct. So I had to make sure that it was. But there was a lot of fear. But I understand what the emotion of fear is. It's a subconscious trigger that causes this feeling that I don't like. And it's a go signal for me, not a stop signal for me. Fear is an emotion. Emotions are all triggered at the subconscious level. They release neurochemicals that causes a feeling. We are consciously aware of feelings that are triggered at the subconscious level. The feeling is the end point of the human experience in the physical body. And so when you have something in your brain that a neural network says, well, what if this book comes out and you fail? What if it's not good enough? What is scientifically not correct? What if? My brain's gonna process that the same way as your brain and everybody else's brain, because that's everybody's brain's the same. The mechanism of how the brain works, it's Einstein's brain, Hitler's brain, Genghis Khan's brain, Tom Bilyeu's brain, John Astor's brain, all the same functionality. So if you understand the mechanics of what's supposed to happen, then you say, okay, great. When I feel this, then what am I going to do? So I like to use an analogy of a car. You're driving a car and you're talking to a friend of yours and a light pops up on the dash. You don't take a hammer and hit a light. It's a signal. Something's happening in the engine, in the trunk, in the tires. Something's happening. Emotions and feelings aren't positive or negative. They're empowering or disempowering to varying degrees if you don't understand them. And so if you think about fear, right? How does a firefighter go into a burning building when there's this enormous adrenaline and epinephrine, you know, that could stop most people dead in their tracks? They learn, here's the feeling, it's normal. Do you have the knowledge and the skills and the preparation to deal with this in a safe way? Go. If you don't, now you retreat. So we have this phenomenal brain, right? It's genius abilities. We can't figure out how to replicate it anywhere with billions of dollars. But we are getting some of the user's manual now. So when you feel fear, what should you do? I teach the first two inner sizes that I teach every one of our students. Number one is called Take Six, Calm the Circuits. So if you have this unpleasant, anxious, fearful emotion, energy in motion, right? And it's unpleasant and the brakes have gone on. If you just take six deep breaths in through your nose, out through your mouth like you're breathing through a straw, you will deactivate the stress response center, which means blood is going to go back to the left prefrontal cortex. The Einstein part of the brain can actually think through this problem, because what happens when the stress response center is activated, blood goes away from that into the fear response. So you have epinephrine, cortisol, adrenaline to be able to get you out of the situation. It's part of our instinctual brain, part of the reptilian brain. The first part of the brain that was developed was that, then the mammalian brain, the limbic system, then the neocortex, the thinking brain. So when our brain has this signal of, oh my God, you might get hurt, you might lose this, you might get in trouble, you might be embarrassed, ashamed, ridiculed, judged, etc., that part of the brain is going to get activated. So if you take six deep breaths first, calm down, calm the circuits first, then do inner size number two, is called AYA, A-I-A. The first A is for awareness. What am I thinking right now? What am I feeling right now? What am I sensing right now? What is my behavior right now? So your thoughts, feelings, sensations, awareness of behavior. What's my intention right now? That's the I. Well, my intention is to move forward. I want to do this. Great. What's one very small action step that you can take? Now, the reason you want to take one small action step is one small action step your brain can handle. If it's one small step towards it, the threat response goes away. But if you focus on the end game right away, you're going to get that rush and that instant trigger of the fear response, stress response. So the first thing you want to do is learn how to manage your mindset and what you focus on. Learn how to manage your emotions, because they drive your behavior more than anything else, because we move away from pain and we move towards pleasure, but we move away from pain 1,000 times faster. And pain wires in the brain faster for survival mechanisms. So purely from a neuroscience perspective, just understanding self, once you understand, oh, okay, this feeling is normal. Okay, what should I do? Take six, calm the circuits, AYA, and now you can start being progressive and make progress towards what you want. Now, while you're in the, you know, in the what am I thinking feeling, it's a chance to be aware. And the biggest gift we have as human beings is our awareness, because awareness is what gives you choice, and choice is what gives you freedom. Most people are living their lives in a reactive state, automatic reactive state, because of these set points that we started talking about. So we're in this repetitive cycle over and over and over and over. We react to the same things. We behave the same way. We eat the same foods. We dress the same way, just to maintain that homeostasis and comfort zones. And we've never been taught. We haven't been given the tools. And then we haven't practiced the tools enough to be able to make them part of our unconscious competence brain. What is a belief? A belief is nothing more than a group of cells that have been connected and then reinforced. Whatever we believe is truth for us, but it's not the truth, right? But we have been conditioned. When you were a baby, when you were born, what belief did you have? Zero. Goose egg, zero, not one. And so you learned what to believe and how to even formulate your beliefs, chances are from parents, teachers, brothers, sisters, television, maybe when you read some books, right? And we behave based on what we believe. So we might be behaving our lives away based on false or inaccurate or disempowering beliefs. So if a belief is a neural pattern in the brain, then we probably have some good ones, empowering ones, useful ones. And chances are we have some that are not useful, not empowering, and not worthy of the geniuses that we all are. So the question is it possible for me to develop new beliefs that I don't believe right now? Mm. The answer is yeah. The process is you can read new beliefs to life. And so if you listen to beliefs that are empowering over and over and over again, and you emotionalize them, and you visualize yourself actually acting out those beliefs, and you learn how to pay attention to that little inner critic that says, that's bullshit, that's not true, that'll never come true, that's not true. If you learn and you remember that that little voice is there to consistently keep you in this homeostatic place, and it's there to protect the beliefs that are there now. The latest research shows that to develop, you know, a new pattern takes between 66 days and 365 days. So you have to use intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. So you have to start everybody off, well, why is it important for you to be able to develop these new beliefs? Like, what would your life be like if you had them right now? What would your family life be like? You have to give them a benefit that's greater than the switch cost. So the switch cost is something that our brain resists. The only human that likes change is a wet baby. Every other human being is resistant to it because safety first and homeostasis and energy conservation. So we are biologically wired not to want to change. So we have to deliberately coax the brain into motivational reasons, emotional reasons. You have to have intrinsic reasons. Why must you do this? And so you can use pain as a frame as well. So if you don't, then are you okay with your life being like this at this age in 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years? And if you're okay with that, then you're not a candidate for change. But if you're committed to letting go of the old so you can create the new, and you create motivations every day, that's where the power is. Progress, not perfection. So anybody can do 1 minute or 10 seconds. So if you can start to formulate a habit, a daily habit, a weekly habit, it doesn't matter how long it is. If you can create that space in your brain that on this day, at this time, this is what I do, and you do that repeatedly, that becomes a habit. And it takes those 66 days or so for a simple habit that you have to consciously do to then the habit doing you. Mm. And that's why they say we are all creatures of habit, because habits run themselves. Their subconscious programs just run themselves. Most people don't take the time to become aware. What are my empowering habits? What are my disempowering habits? And then the next question is, well, how do I release this one? And how do I strengthen this one or create a whole new one? And what we're looking to do is build empowering habits that then run their course.